तेजस्वी नावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै
looking at some of the standard signals which we come across in the study of networks and systems and their waveforms. You recall among these standard signal waveforms we mentioned the DC signal, then the sinusoid. A cos omega t plus theta being its general expression. We also mentioned that the exponential signal A e to the power of s t, where s is a complex number in general, sigma plus j omega, plays also an important role. We term this quantity S as the complex frequency simply for the reason that it has the dimensions of 1 over time, something per second. And something per second is called frequency, and since this is general complex, we call it a complex frequency. We should not read more meaning into that. We should not interpret this as indicating a repetitive phenomena like a periodic phenomenon. We also mentioned that any signal like that in general will yield a complex value for real values of time. So in order for us to have a real function of time, every such signal is accompanied, e to the power of st is always accompanied by a conjugate e to the power of s conjugate t, in fact every time in a physical situation where you have a such signal, this corresponding signal with the conjugate coefficient and conjugate of the complex frequency will be present simultaneously. These two will yield a real signal 2a e to the power of sigma t cosine omega t plus phi, where a is the magnitude of this complex coefficient a bar and phi is the angle associated with its complex number a. So this is the, and we saw for different values of sigma and omega, different natures of their values, positive or negative as the case may be, we saw how the waveforms look like. Associated with this exponential signal, we have a special cases e to the power of j omega t. This is a very important signal in that a sinusoid is closely related to this. This is a special case of e to the power of st. This is also an exponential signal, but the value or the complex frequency is purely imaginary. And if you have cos omega t, this is always e to the power of j omega t plus e to the power of minus j omega t by 2. And similarly, sin omega t is e to the power of j omega t minus e to the power of minus j omega t divided by 2j. So a sinusoidal functions of time, cosine omega t and sine omega t, can always be expressed in terms of e to the power of j omega t, and this is a special case of the exponential signal with a complex frequency. In fact, e to the power of j omega t can be thought of as almost synonymous with a sinusoidal quantity, because after all the real part of that yields cos omega t, the imaginary part of the sin omega t. And it is always convenient for us whenever we have to deal with excitation functions of the type cos omega t or sin omega t, to replace it immediately by e to the power of j omega t, because we recognize the cos omega t as the real part of e to the power of j omega t and work with e to the power of j omega t, and finally take the real part of the solution to get the resultant that we would get if indeed the excitation had been cos omega t. More about this we will learn later, but we can always say that e to the power of j omega t, we can always use that whenever we have to use a sinusoidal functions of time. Very often that turns out to be the case. And in fact, manipulation of e to the power of j omega t is easier than manipulation of trigonometric functions, because you have only one function to deal with, and differentiation and integration of e to the power of j omega t exponential function is convenient than differentiation and integration of trigonometric functions, because you alternately switch to cosine and sine with plus sine and minus sine and so forth. It is much more convenient to handle e to the power of j omega t. Now, a characteristic of all these functions are that you can, their derivatives exist up to an infinite order. So DC signal, sinusoid, you can go on taking the derivatives, successive derivatives. They are all smooth functions and all the derivatives exist. Before we proceed further, let me take examples of signals and say what complex frequencies terms are present in these signals. So let us, as an exercise, let us take an example. So I will write down a series of signals which are not the elementary kind that we have been talking about, but then they are composed of signals of this type, e to the power of st, complex frequency signals. Then complex frequency is present in the signal. What are the components which have certain complex frequencies in the present in the signal? So we'll take one by one. Cos 2t plus 30 degrees. Now this is a pure sinusoidal signal, but as I said, cos 2t can always be expressed as e to the power of j 2t and so on. Therefore, the complex frequencies present here is r plus or minus j2. E to the power of j 2t, e to the power of minus j 2t. Together, those terms will be present with appropriate coefficients, a and a conjugate, and these are the two complex frequencies present. In the complex frequency plane, this is the complex frequency plane with the x-axis representing sigma and the y-axis representing omega. You have, therefore, two frequencies at plus 2 and minus 2. Second, suppose I have 2 cos t, cos 3t plus 4 sin 3t. Again, you have a sinusoid. Naturally, you can combine these two into cos, some a cos 3t plus theta. But even if as they are, you have the complex frequencies present here, plus or minus j3, and so are the complex frequencies here. So plus or minus j3 are the complex frequencies present in this particular signal. And once again, you can portray them in the complex frequency plane in the same manner as per the first example. As a third example, suppose I say e to the power of minus 2t plus e to the power of minus 3t cos 4t plus theta. Here, as far as the first signal is concerned, first part of this signal is concerned, e to the power of minus 2t. Therefore, there is a complex frequency where omega is 0 and sigma equals minus 2. So that is the complex frequency associated with this component. The complex frequency associated with this component is minus 3 corresponding to sigma. You recall that if you have a e to the power of st, sigma plus j omega, e to the power of sigma t plus cos omega t plus p. Therefore, minus 3 is the value of sigma, and corresponding to the cosine term, we have plus or minus j4. So as far as this signal is concerned, there are three frequencies, complex frequencies present here. minus 2 and minus 3 plus r minus j 4. So in the complex plane here, you have one frequency at this location and another conjugate frequencies at minus 3, this is minus 2, this is 4, this is minus 4, sigma. Suppose I have e to the power of j 2t plus e to the power of minus 3t cos 4t plus theta, again as before. Now, corresponding to this, you have j 2, and corresponding to this, as before, minus 3 plus r minus j 4. Notice here that this e to the power of j2, there is plus j2, there is no minus j2. That means this particular signal is not a real function of time. So you very rarely you will come across this. You should not come across this for any, as long as the signals are real, real functions of time. Therefore, just to indicate that this is not a realistic signal that you are likely to come across, I just gave an example. So if you substitute a particular value of t, you get an imaginary term. So this is a this is not a type of signal you are likely to encounter. Whenever you have e to the power of j2t, you will also should have e to the power of minus j2t, so that those two together will give rise to a real function of time. But mathematically, if you are looking at this hypothetical signal, these are the frequencies present there. Lastly, suppose I have 4 plus 5 e to the power of 2t cos 5t plus theta. Now this constant term dc can be thought of as a special case of this, where both sigma and omega are 0. When s equals 0, this is a constant. Therefore, a dc corresponds to s equals 0. So you have a frequency corresponding to s equals 0, and corresponding to the second term, you have plus 2 plus r minus j5. So in the complex plane, you have a DC term corresponding to the point sitting right at the origin, and you have two points corresponding to 2 plus r minus j5. And what it means is these two frequencies together will give rise to a term which is e to the power of 2t cos 5t plus theta, or whatever it is. Therefore, it is a growing oscillations, a sinusoid which is growing in its amplitude, and generally those are signals which are you are not likely to come across as far as a physical situation is concerned, because you can come across those such signals for a limited period. They can't go on indefinitely, because they reach infinite proportions with respect to time. So as long as you have a sustained signal which can last for a long time or forever, then you need to have a negative real part, because you have seen from the waveforms of the complex exponential signals for different values of sigma and omega that we plotted in the last lecture, that if you have the real part of the complex frequency positive, it represents a growing signal. Now, all these signals, as I mentioned, are those which are smooth, which are continuous by themselves, and also have continuous derivatives. There is a need to have a compact notation for signals which are discontinuous, which are either discontinuous or have discontinuous derivatives. Take, for example, this particular function. of time, or for that matter, another one like this. Suppose these are the two functions of time that are given to you. F2 and t. It is difficult to describe this analytically because we have to say that function is 0 for negative values of time, and from this point to this point it has got certain, you give an analytical expression for this, from this point you give another analytical expression for this, and beyond that once again you say it to 0. Similarly, if you want to describe this f of t analytically, you have to say it is 0 for negative values of time, it is a constant up to for t in this range, another constant for t in this range, and it has got a certain straight line relation in this range, and beyond that it is 0. That means you have to describe, give separate expressions for 5 different regions as far as this function f2 is concerned. So it becomes a little cumbersome, but one would like to see if we can express this by means of some notational expression, some notations, just like as we have said this is ae to the power of st. Is it possible for us to arrive at some kind of expression for these signals f1 and f2 where we don't have to qualify them further as saying this is valid for this interval of time and this expression is valid for a different interval of time. And this leads us to the topic of what is called singularity functions, which are used to describe functions of this type, which are discontinuous by themselves or have discontinuous derivatives. And it is the singularity functions which we'll take up for discussion later. And one of the most important singularity functions is the unit step function, which I will describe in a moment. This is originally introduced into the literature by Oliver Heaviside, a British engineer who made signal contributions to communication theory and operational methods of analysis of networks and systems. He was a controversial figure, and most of his work was not founded on rigorous mathematics, so he got into trouble with mathematicians of his day, but he introduced the step function among other things and the operational calculus methods, and as a retort to the mathematicians who were not happy with his work, he would say, "Do I stop eating because I don't exactly understand the process of digestion?" That was his retort to those people who were critical of his work, because he introduced some methods and they were working, and so he said, "Why should you probe further into this? As long as it produces results, you should be happy with them." That is just a brief historical note on Oliver Heaviside, who introduced the unit step function, which we'll take up now. We shall now take a look at three important singularity functions. These are called singularity functions because either they have discontinuities or the derivatives have discontinuities. And therefore, in the regular classical sense of mathematics, they don't have derivatives. If derivative fails to be continuous, in classical mathematics you say it doesn't have a derivative. So it is singular at that point. I mean, that is why these are called singularity functions. The most important, perhaps, is the unit step function. And this is what I said was introduced by Oliver Heaviside. This is indicated as u of t. Symbolically, it is represented as u of t. And this is defined as 1 for t greater than 0 and 0 for t less than 0. So the waveform for this would be, it is 0 up to this point, t, this time axis t, 0. And then from this point downwards, it has a value 1. So as a function of time, it has got a waveform like this. 0 for negative values of t and a constant 1 for positive values of t. At t equals 0 itself at this point, we don't really care what it is. It can be left undefined. You can take it as 1 if you wish, 0 as you if you like, or half, whatever it is. Normally, we were not really concerned in most of the work. It does not matter how you take it. So we leave it undefined. But if really it becomes necessary, you take it as half. because it is the average of the right and left extreme limits. And in some limiting process, it will converge to that value half, so you may take it as half. But in any case, the important thing here is that it is a discontinuous function of time. It is the left hand limit is 0, and then suddenly it jumps by a value 1 and stays constant from that point onwards. So it resembles a step here at this point, a steep rise, and that's why it's called a step function. And since this height of the step is 1, it is called a unit step function, u of t. Now, using this unit step function, we can describe a number of other functions of time which have discontinuities. So let us take a series of examples to illustrate how the unit step function can be used to describe different types of functions. Suppose I have a function which has got four units for positive t and 0 for negative values of time, then obviously this will be described as 4 times ut, because it is the same unit step function enlarged 4 times. So the amplitude is 4. 4 ut is this function. Suppose I have a step function which starts at t equals 2 and 0 for negative values, for values of t less than 2, then you would, and the magnitude of this is suppose 1, then you would call that u of t minus 2, because as long as the argument t minus 2 is positive, t greater than 2, it has 1. If t is less than 2, u of t minus 2 is a unit function, step function of the argument negative values, then therefore it becomes 0. So this describes u, this function is described by u t minus 2. You can also see if this is u of t, it is translated in time, delayed by 2 seconds. Therefore, if this is f of t, this must be f of t minus 2. Therefore, on that argument also, you can show, you can see that this is u of t minus 2. Suppose I have a function like this, 1 for t less than 2 and 0 for t greater than 2. So what will you describe this function as? Now this function has a value 1 as long as t is less than 2. Therefore, if you write u of 2 minus t, that describes this function, because as long as t is less than 2, 2 minus t is a positive number, and therefore it must have a value 1. And as long as t exceeds 2, 2 minus t is a negative value, therefore it becomes 0. That's how it goes. Let me now take a case where you have a function whose value is minus 4 for t less than 2. Therefore, this is u of t minus t, but instead of having plus 1, it has a value minus 4. Therefore, this will be minus 4 u of 2 minus t. That's how it is described. You can substitute different values of t, and it, see that it is in accordance with the definition of the unit step function. Unit step function is also useful in describing functions like this. This is a kind of pulse, sometimes called a gate function, because it's like a gate between this interval. The signal is there, afterwards the signal is not there at all. Now, such functions can be easily shown to be the sum of two functions. For example, if I have a step function starting at 2, say f1, and another function f2 starting at 3, notice that if I subtract f2 from f1, from t equals 3 onwards, this area is cancelled out by this area. And what is left is only the value or the function between 2 and 3, and that is exactly what we are having. So a gate function or a pulse function can, like this, can be written as u of t minus 2. U of t minus 2 would be a step starting at 2 seconds and going on forever. You want to pull down that step to 0. Therefore, at this point 3, you have to introduce a negative step of unit magnitude so that the original step that was going like this, from that you are subtracting a negative step so that from point t equals 3 onwards, it becomes 0. So you need to subtract from this u of t minus 3. So you can see that a pulse like this can be described in terms of step functions as u of t minus 2 minus u of t minus 3. So this is a very useful concept which we can use to describe discontinuous functions of this type. Another example. Suppose you have this function which is symmetrically situated around the origin. Then you can think of this as a step function starting at this point and subtract from that a negative step starting at this point. The step function starting at minus 2 has 4 units. Therefore, 4 u of t plus 2 you must write, because for t less than minus 2, then t plus 2 is negative, therefore this is 0. As long as t is greater than minus 2, or t plus 2 is positive, you have a value 4. Therefore, 4 u of t plus 2 is a step which is going like this. But then, you don't want this step to continue forever. At this point, plus 2, you want to introduce a negative step of 4 units so that this portion is cancelled by this. So from this you subtract minus 4 u of t minus 2. So this, the sum of these two is indeed this pulse that we are having. A little more complicated situation. So suppose this is 1, this is 2, this is minus 1, time 2, 3, this is t. So this goes on like that forever. Beyond t equals 3, this continues at minus 1. So to describe this, always what you should do is, you should start with the first step and see what are the other steps that you have to be added to that in order to describe the actual situation. So this function is 0 up to this point, and at that point it jumps by value 1. So you can write this as u of t minus 1. That describes a step, unit step starting at t equals 1 and going on like that. And that explains satisfactorily the given function of time from t equals minus infinity on up to 2. This function describes the behavior at this point. At this point, the function jumps up by another amount equal to 1. So to this step, you have to add another step of unit amplitude. So that will be another unit step starting at t equals 2. So u of t minus 2. And now what is the effect of these two steps? You have 0 up to this point, 1, and then it continues like this. So the effect of these two would lead to us, it would give us a curve which goes like this and then continues like this. But then what happens? At t equals 3, we must bring this down to minus 1. So you must introduce a negative step of 3 units in order to pull this value down to minus 1. So minus of 3 u of t minus 3. If you do that, then this value is pulled down to minus 1. And then from that point onwards, it continues at a constant value. You can verify the result. After all, u of t equals 1 for t greater than 0. Therefore, suppose you take a large value of t, say 6 or 7. Then this is 1, and this is minus 3. So 1 plus 1 minus 3 is minus 1. So indeed, that is minus 1. So for any value of t greater than 3, this is going to be minus 1. So these examples are to illustrate the usefulness of the step function in describing discontinuous functions and are piecewise constant functions, and you must get the facility, must develop the facility of describing such functions by means of appropriate steps with appropriate weights and appropriate shifts in time, as we have indicated by means of these examples. The next singularity function that we would like to talk about is what is called the unit ramp function. This is also a causal signal like the u of t, in that it is 0 for negative values of time. It is indicated as rt, and it is defined as t for t greater than or equal to 0, and 0 for t less than 0. So it's clear that its waveform would be like this. It goes on like this. And it has a value 1 when time t equals 1. So it is, for positive t, it is described as t. And for negative values, it is 0. So this is called a ramp function because this is like a ramp, a slope. So it is called a ramp function. And since the slope is equal to 1, it is called a unit ramp function. The slope of this, suppose I indicate the slope by brackets, this is slope equal to 1. It rises by unit amount and unit time. This is called the unit ramp function. Now, unit ramp function, once again, let me illustrate its applications through examples. See how we can describe several interesting wave shapes through the unit ramp function. Suppose I have a function like this, which is 0 for t less than 1, and increases at the rate of 1 unit per unit distance traveled along the x-axis, then this would be called r of t minus 1, because it's the same unit ramp function shifted in time, delayed in time by 1 second, and therefore this will be r t minus 1. We should be able to recognize whenever a function is delayed by an amount tau, then f of t becomes f of t minus tau. Suppose it starts at 1 and is a negative going ramp. At 2, it is equal to minus 1. Then it will be minus of r of t minus 1. It is a ramp function with a coefficient of minus 1, and it starts at t equals 1. That's how you describe it. Suppose I have a function which is 0 for positive, for values of t beyond 3 in the positive direction, and then it increases in the negative direction of t with a slope equal to 3, or slope in the, as t increases, is minus 3. Then, first of all, it is the ramp function has values for t less than 3. Therefore, you must have basically something like r 3 minus t. Because when t exceeds 3, this becomes 0. When t exceeds 3, 3 minus t is a negative number, and therefore this is 0. So basically, you have r of 3 minus t. Now, you must fix the coefficient to suit this. Now, when t equals 0, for example, then this is equal to 9. The slope is 3. Therefore, if you put here 3, r t minus 3, this becomes, answers this description, because all you have to do is, you must ensure that this is negative for t greater than 3, and therefore the break point comes at t equals 3. And beyond that, if you fix one point on the straight line gets fixed up. Therefore, when t equals 0, this is r of 3. R of t is equal to t. R of 3 is equal to 3. Therefore, 3 times 3 is 9, and that answers this particular description. So that's how one can fix up this. You can do it in different ways, but at least this is one argument to show that f of t is equal to 3r, 3 minus t. As a fourth example, suppose I have a triangular wave shape, 1, minus 1, 4. This is a function which you can decompose as, first of all, at t equals minus 1, there is a step, there is a ramp function going up like this. At t equals minus 1, so if a ramp starts at minus 1 and increases with a slope of 4, then you would describe this as 4 r t plus 1. Because this is delayed, this is advanced in time by 1 unit, therefore r of t plus 1. So such a line, that is a line starting from here and then going on like this, would be called 4 r t plus 1. All right. Now, if this is the line that is going, then this describes a waveform which is going like this. But now at this point, at t equals 0, you must introduce, you must pull this down by so that it will have a slope of minus 4 from that point onwards. Therefore, in order to pull this down to introduce a resultant slope of minus 4, this has a slope of plus 4. At this point, you must introduce a negative going ramp to pull down the slope to minus 4. So at this point, you must introduce here another ramp with a slope of minus 8 units. This has a slope of plus 4 units. This must have a slope of minus 8 units. And this ramp is introduced at t equals 0. Therefore, this will be called minus 8 r of t. That will be that particular characteristic, which starts at t equals 0 and has a negative slope. Now, what is the result of these two? If you have these two together, then you load out these increases. At this point, you pull this down, and then it's going on like this. Now, at t equals 1, we must arrest this downward slope. We must put this back to 0. That means this slope, resultant slope of minus 4, must be stopped, and then it must be restored to a DC 0 slope. Therefore, at t equals 1, you must introduce another ramp with a positive slope of 4 units so that particular ramp and this, what you had earlier picked up, will lead to a 0 identically for values of t beyond 1. And therefore, this would be called 4 r of, this ramp is introduced at t equals 1, therefore 4 r t minus 1. So ultimately, this particular, and if you do that, then this resultant negative slope and then this positive slope will be cancelled out, and yielding identically a 0 value for t equals 1 onwards. Therefore, this particular triangular waveform can be described as 4r t plus 1 minus 8rt plus 4r t minus 1, the sum of these three. That is how this ramp function can be employed. Notice that rt is not equal to t. They are not the same. Rt is a function like this, whereas t is a function like this. This is rt, this is t. T has a value for negative values of time as well, whereas rt is 0 for negative values of time. You can, however, say rt equals t times ut. You can say that. Because if you take this t and multiply by unit step function, the negative values will be multiplied by 0, it gets cancelled out. And for positive t, the t multiplied by 1, t ut will provide rt. So rt can be written alternatively if you wish as t ut, but it can't be equal to t by itself. The last singularity function which we will talk about is the unit delta function or unit impulse function. It is also called unit delta function. Also referred as unique Dirac delta function because it was introduced by Dirac. Now one can introduce this in this fashion. Suppose I have a symmetrically situated pulse, symmetrically situated around the origin of width d and height 1 over d. So this pulse has a width d and a height 1 over d. And now let us imagine what happens when d is reduced to by a factor 2. Then the pulse width diminishes, but the height increases so that the area under the curve is 1. So the area is equal to 1. So maintaining that area, you have to make, as you make d smaller and smaller, then the pulse width becomes smaller, but the height grows, so that the area under the curve is maintained equal to 1. And this is d by 2, this is minus d by 2, and it's still centered around the origin. So imagine what happens when d goes to 0. When d goes to 0, you should have ideally, a pulse which has got 0 width, but a height which is infinitely large. So that is what is called the impulse function or delta function, which is indicated because we can't mark the point at infinity in a blackboard or in your notebook. We'll indicate an arrow like this and say this is 1, indicating that the area under this curve is equal to 1, and this is called delta t. This function is called delta t. So delta t is, we can define it in this manner. Limit as d goes to 0, of this symmetrically situated pulse width d and height 1 over d. That is one way of defining this delta function. You can also think of, start with other waveforms like triangle waveform and take the limit and it goes to 1. That is also possible, but we will confine our discussion to this. A second way of defining delta t mathematically would be to say delta t equals 0 for t not equal to 0. So this is 0 for every value of t except t equals 0. At t equals 0, it has infinite height, but we don't know how to describe this. So all we can say is if you integrate delta t from an interval AB such that 0 is in between A and B, that means the range of integration includes that delta, this is equal to 1. That means the area under this curve, this infinitely large amplitude 0 width curve, is said to be equal to 1. And therefore, as you integrate through the origin, integral from A to B of delta t dt equal to 1. So that is one way of defining this. A third way of looking at this delta function is this. Delta t equals 0 for t not equal to 0 as before. But suppose you take a function f of t, multiply by delta t, and integrate from A to B. Then what do you have? You have this delta function multiplying a function f of t. So you have a continuous function. Let us say f of t is a continuous function, and then you are having this delta function. When you multiply this, it is 0 everywhere except at this point. At this point, f of t is multiplied by delta t. So f0, this value, f0 is this value, is multiplying this delta t. And the integral delta t dt is equal to 1. All we have now is, instead of delta t dt, you have f0 delta t dt. Therefore, this is equal to f0. So this is another way of looking at a delta function. Any continuous function f of t, if you multiply by delta t and integrate, it samples that value of f of t at the point where the delta is situated. Delta is situated at t equals 0. So you want to find out the value of the function f of t at t equals 0, you multiply f of t delta t dt, integrate, you get f of t. So these are all equivalent ways of looking at this delta function. We can adopt this as the definition. Sometimes you can even use this as a definition, or you can take this as a definition. All are equivalent ways of looking at this. Important thing is that this delta function is something, again, as I mentioned, which may not be, which is not coming under the fold of the classical mathematics. So originally, when it was introduced by applied mathematicians and engineers, and later on, mathematicians established a theory called theory of distributions, which makes the manipulation of delta functions, puts it on a more sound basis of rigorous mathematics, and therefore we don't go into the theory of distributions, but there is a branch of mathematics called theory of distributions which gives a theoretical basis to the use and manipulation of delta functions. Okay, so let me now plot some examples of how different types of delta functions can be thought, can be conceived. Suppose I have 4 delta t. It is an impulse function standing at t equals 0, and its magnitude is 4. I mean, we indicate its magnitude 4 in the sense that it's no doubt infinity, but the area under the curve is 4 units. So the magnitude of a delta is indicated within brackets in this fashion. Suppose I have 3 delta t minus 2. It means the magnitude of this delta function is 3, but it is now sitting at t equals 2, because the argument of the delta is 0, then only delta exists, otherwise it is 0. That means this will be t equals 2 and its magnitude is 3. That's how 3 delta t minus 2 looks like. Suppose you have minus 3 delta t plus 4. It means that at t equals minus 4, that is the position where delta is fixed, and its a value equals minus 3. Therefore, it's a negative going impulse with a magnitude of minus 3. That's how it goes. A few further properties. Delta t equals delta minus t. It's an even function of time. So delta t exists at t equals 0. Delta minus t also exists at t equals 0 and nothing else. Therefore, whether it's plus 0 or minus 0, it makes no difference. Therefore, this is an even function of time. Secondly, delta t multiplied by f of t equals f0 multiplied by delta t, because f of t multiplied by delta t is 0 for all values of t except t equals 0. So the value, if at all it is, it exists only at t equals 0. At that time, f0 times delta t is the value that we have. Thirdly, if I integrate delta t minus t naught times f of t dt over a range which includes t naught, then obviously this will be, everywhere this integrand is 0, except when t equals t naught, because at that time delta t minus t naught exists. So at that time, f t naught, which is a constant, delta t minus t naught is delta function is being integrated. Therefore, this will yield f t naught. So this will yield f t naught. That's how it goes. In other words, if you multiply f of t, delta t naught, this is after all f of t naught, delta t minus t naught, and you integrate f of t naught, delta t minus t naught dt. Whenever you integrate via delta, the value increases by 1 unit, and that 1 unit multiplied by f of t naught leads this result. So this can be put in this fashion. Whenever you integrate via delta at a particular point, suppose you have some kind of curve like this, which includes a delta function, if you integrate that at this point, because of delta, it jumps by 1 unit. Because of the delta function. To summarize, we had in this course of this lecture reviewed the concept of complex frequency signal and identified the complex frequency components present in some example signals which we have taken up. And then later on, we introduced ourselves to the 3 singularity functions which play a very important role in describing functions which are either continuous or have discontinuous, which are either discontinuous by themselves or have discontinuous derivatives. The 3 functions that we have familiarized ourselves with are the unit step function, the unit ramp function, and the unit delta function. All these play a very important role in describing either response variables or excitation variables which are piecewise continuous but have discontinuities at some point, either in themselves or in their derivatives. We will take up some examples involving the use of these functions in our next lecture.